You may remember that last term in his Commemoration Day address, the Rector of Imperial College, Lord Flowers, launched an appeal to all graduating students. This appeal was in the form of a covenant scheme to benefit the college's non-academic services. Well, the success of this appeal was just one of the topics I raised when I interviewed Lord Flowers at the end of last term. We also talked about college and student union financing and the proposed student loan scheme. In addition, I asked Lord Flowers about his many activities outside Imperial College, including the controversial Flowers report on the future of London's teaching hospitals. I met the Rector in his office in the Sherfield Building. My first question was, which aspects of your position as head of IC do you enjoy most?
Well, Imperial College is the leading university institution of science and technology in the country, and I could not possibly not enjoy leading such an institution. It's enormous fun, it's very well worthwhile. It gives me, if you like, also a national base for making pronouncements from time to time about matters scientific and technological, and that is an important consideration too. If you ask me what I don't like about it, I think the only things that I don't like are the things that one has to accept in a job like this, at times when money is in short supply and one sometimes has to take hard decisions to cut back in certain areas where one knows that one is doing a certain amount of damage unavoidably. One can't enjoy that, but one does it in order that the institution shall survive as well as possible. And so that is part of the job, and one must just accept it.
Yes, of course, last year you forecast that Imperial College would have to save something like £1 million this year. How does this year's budget compare with that of last year?
Well, we got a little bit of a windfall from the University Grants Committee that had made a great battle with the government to get the total UGC budget up. And so the year ended not as badly as we had, all of us in the universities, had feared. In addition to that, we managed to cut out something approaching £500,000 worth of expenditure, most on administrative services and things of that sort. And of course, we are gradually coming round to charging for all services at rates that make them pay for themselves. I mean refectories and halls of residence and so on. This is one of the things I don't like having to do because it's putting up the cost to students. But it is essential if our academic activities can continue. And so far we haven't had to cut any academic activities. So what with a bit of a windfall and with cutting back on services of one kind or another or making them pay for themselves, we are all right for this year. Next year we are in much the same state as we were 12 months ago, where the uncertainties in what our budget would be or what it was supposed to cover at any rate are very great. And we have budgeted for quite a large deficit budget. What we hope is, of course, that things will not turn out quite as badly as that budget forecasts. But it is a bit of a gamble, and if it turns out wrong, we shall be much worse off the year after. So we are continuing to study ways of cutting back on things that are not absolutely essential.
The last time that we interviewed you was just after your Commemoration Day address, in which you asked each graduating student to covenant £100 to the college over the next 5 years. Are you now able to make a statement on the results of the appeal so far?
Yes, although it's a provisional statement. We are now beginning to get covenants. I'm not quite sure how many come from students, but from Commemoration Day, something like £6,000 has been covenanted. I have to say that I'm disappointed at the response. It doesn't show the spirit that I had hoped that it would. I'd hoped that by now many more would have come through, but they are beginning to trickle through. And they will, I think, mount up. At any rate, it has enabled us through the Queensgate Trust already to announce that we're going to do something about women's changing rooms in the boathouse. This is something that we could not possibly, in present circumstances, have done using UGC funds. So although the amount is small, it has enabled us to do something that we otherwise couldn't have done. So perhaps that's an illustration of what I was saying at Commem, that we need resources that we can use freely as we see fit, on things that the college really needs. I hope that our new graduates and others will respond vigorously to our requests for money of this kind, and there will be further appeals going out later on to other sectors of the college.
Yes, so you believe, for instance, that the student should at least have the opportunity to repay the college something for his education and his degree. Will this appeal be extended to students' graduation in future years?
Oh, yes.
Yes. Yes. Well, in fact, continuing on the theme of finance, there is a current proposal to replace student grants with a loan scheme, the money being repayable after graduation. Would you yourself be in favour of such a scheme?
Well, it's a considerable change in the philosophy of financing universities for this country. It's an arrangement that has been common in other countries for quite some time. It seems to work, for example, in Sweden. One of the fears, namely that students would not in fact repay, especially overseas students, doesn't seem to be borne out in the experience of those countries that do it. What I'm rather afraid of is that it makes it more difficult for students who are going into activities in future life that do not make them well off. I mean, for example, school teachers who are not a particularly well-off part of society. They will find it harder to carry this burden than people who become, I don't know, financiers or whatever. So there are problems about it, but it is a way of funding universities that does work and could work here. As far as I know, the government doesn't particularly favour this approach, so we shall have to see.
Now, as from next year, the new system of financing student unions comes into operation, whereby the union competes with all other areas of college for a share of the block grant. Is the union likely to have to make substantial cuts in spending in the next 2 years?
Well, you know, this was exactly the system that the college has operated for a very long time until this year.
Aye.
And we did it for a special reason this year, because we felt that we could get extra money by funding the union through the local authorities, yes, effectively.
So, in fact, the union is more used to...
It's much more used to being paid for from the block grant. Mm-hmm. So. I don't think the union will find any particular difficulty with that system. If you ask whether the union will lose money, it will, like all other parts of the college, find itself hard up. But I don't see that it need find itself more hard up than anybody else. They will get fair treatment.
Yes, I see. Well, I'd like to digress from college at this point and talk a little more about yourself. Now, you've said in the past that the head of a place such as Imperial College should be involved in other spheres of public life, and certainly you seem to be no exception. I note, for instance, that you were on the Royal Commission for Environmental Pollution and also a member of the Society for Clean Air. How deep is your concern for the environment in which we live?
It is very deep. The problem, of course, is not that one should care for the environment by itself. If one's only concern was to preserve the environment, one would not be able to do anything, because all activity in some way or other affects the environment. Likewise, one cannot consider only industrial progress, only the making of money, with no concern for the environment, because if you do, you may become wealthier, but the environment in which you live, what you enjoy in life, deteriorates. So what we have to do is to try to strike a reasonable balance between wealth creation in all its forms and the preservation of human values, of which the environment is one important part. And I have devoted 6 years as chairman of the Royal Commission that you mentioned, and a little while as president of the National Society for Clean Air, to trying to define that balance a little better.
I see. I've also done much work connected with atomic structure and nuclear reactions. Do you personally believe that we should be looking to nuclear energy as our major power source for the future?
Nuclear energy is bound to be one of our major power sources for the future. For the next 20 or 30 years, we are going to have to rely upon increased nuclear energy and increased coal production and also upon, of course, trying to conserve energy better so that we don't need quite as much as we otherwise should. There is really nothing that can take the place of these things, given that oil supplies are gradually getting more and more difficult, certainly getting much more expensive. They're going to become less easy to get hold of in the future. In perhaps 20 or 30 years' time, the scene may change, because many countries now, our own included, are working on other forms of energy, energy from the wind, energy from the waves. We're very well placed in this country to take advantage of the energy of the waves and of the tides too, to a certain extent. Yes. These are major new technologies that have to be developed over the next 20, 30 years. They are all much more difficult than they sound. They cannot happen overnight. And although I believe that there is great potential in them, it is 30 years hence that we shall start seeing major contributions from some of them, at least. Yes. And during that period, we can really do nothing other than to rely upon the three things I mentioned: nuclear power, coal, and conservation.
I see. Now, of course, in the last few months, you yourself have been the target of much criticism, including an open door program on the BBC, as a result of the Flowers report, which recommended some amalgamation of some of the London teaching hospitals. Could you very briefly outline why you were asked to make such a study and why you came to your particular conclusions?
Well, I was asked to make the study by the medicals themselves. For 12 years and more, the University of London has been trying to grapple with its medical school structure. And it has been a very difficult problem. London has, at the present time, 34 semi-autonomous medical schools and postgraduate institutes. That's a large number of more or less autonomous bodies. Very difficult structure to control in any way. And the deans of the medical schools and other important people in London medicine have been grappling with this problem and had come to the point when they realized that something serious would have to be done, that if the financial climate continued to deteriorate, and this was before high fees for overseas students, which has now made it very much worse for them, they had to contemplate the idea that one or more schools or institutes might have to close to enable the others to do their job properly. But they also realized that they would find it extremely difficult to make the choice themselves. And so they asked that a committee be set up to make recommendations and to analyze the problem.
Yes.
If you ask why I was asked to do it, the chief reason is because Imperial College doesn't have a medical school, and so it is not in any way committed to any particular solution. And so I was asked to do this, and I did it. The purpose of my report really was not so much to make specific recommendations, although we did make specific recommendations, and they have been bitterly fought, of course, but then we knew they would be, whatever we said.
Yes.
But to analyze the problem, to bring it home to everyone, what the problem was, and especially what the problem would be if nothing were done, and to try to persuade the medical community itself to really to grapple with the problem at last. Now, I would like to pay a very big tribute to the medical community in London, that after the initial shock had worn off, and after they had begun to grapple with the real problems, by the end of the summer, they had come out with a compromise proposal that was very much like my proposals in many ways, but differed in certain important respects, toned it down a bit, wasn't quite so rough, and so on. They came out really with a plan which I believe would have worked and would have been, after some time, acceptable. And we almost had it through. And then, as often happens in a university, the Senate came into the act, as it has to,
yes,
before the end of the day, of course. And there the matter was discussed by a lot of people who had not been introduced to the problem before, and who, characteristically of all university senates, resist change. And so that threw a spanner in the works, not an unexpected spanner, I may say. And by a very narrow majority, 27-25, which means one person voting differently would have changed it. The proposals were not exactly rejected, but postponed at any rate until next February, when the Senate meets again to discuss the matter. At that February meeting, we shall have the cost estimates of various options before us, prepared by a totally independent committee, which is looking at those costing features much more than I was able to do. And that should help us to come to firm conclusions in February. At least I hope so, because the whole medical faculty is suffering now from uncertainty that has gone on too long. And I believe that they would really, in the end, welcome a solution soon, rather than postpone it any longer in the hope of making things a little bit better.
Yes. Well, now coming back to Imperial College, do you forecast any significant changes in college life in the near future as a result of financial cutback or any such thing?
I think there are two things that one has to mention straight off. There may be many other little things that we can't foresee. I mentioned already that we're having to make all services that are not strictly academic cost-effective, stand on their own feet, not make a loss, such as refectories
and residences.
Yeah. That is one major change. There will not be the sort of subsidies that there have been in the past. The other major change, which I believe in the long run is much more important, is that the high fees for overseas students have reduced this year our number of overseas students by about a quarter, by about 25%. That is, incidentally, what we predicted would happen. And all the information that I have so far through the UCA admissions house is that overseas students will be reduced by another substantial percentage next year.
Yes.
The latest prediction is about a 40% drop next year over this year. I'm talking about the university as a whole now.
Yes.
I don't know what that will imply for Imperial College, but it might be another quarter. And if so, we shall be faced with a situation where we have only about half the overseas students that we've been accustomed to having. And most of these will be postgraduate students. And that is going to change the character of the college very drastically.
Yes.
Because we have always been a very international place, and we do not want to be otherwise. And we've always been a heavily postgraduate place, and we do not want to be otherwise. And so there are very serious implications for the college. Moreover, quite apart from the fact that getting rid of a lot of overseas students changes the nature of the place, we are not allowed to make up for the sheer numbers by increasing the number of home students very much. Because under the new arrangements which led to these high overseas fees, universities in future are going to be financed in terms of their home students from the University Grants Committee. And we have been warned that if we increase the number of home students, the amount of money we get from the UGC will not be increased, and therefore the amount of money we have per student would go down. And that would affect our standards and, again, the nature of the place that we are. So we're facing very serious problems of a qualitative kind as well as purely financial kind.
Yes, well, finally then, in spite of the difficulties that you've just mentioned, do you believe that Imperial College can maintain its standing in the country, as you mentioned at the beginning, as one of the foremost colleges, and indeed its standing in the world?
I have no doubt about being able to maintain our standards in the country. I believe that we shall maintain our standards in the world also, but in a somewhat trimmed down sense in terms of the numbers of people who come to us from overseas. I believe what we have to do now is to insist upon our quality. I do not believe that we should try to encourage overseas students to come to us simply because they can pay the high fees and therefore bring benefit with them to the college unless they can meet the kind of standards that we've always expected of all our students. I would hate to see two societies at Imperial College. Those students who are good academically, good and in other ways good, and those who simply come because they have money in their pockets. Yes. That would create a very bad situation indeed. But I have no doubt whatsoever that we shall survive. We shall survive with our heads high, somewhat battered perhaps, and that our standards will not drop, and that will be recognised throughout the world.
Lord Flowers, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.